I have a neck here that was ordered by a client for a 4-string bass, and he ordered it from Carvin. And a couple things I want to note about it is that it has a 10-degree, actually when I measured it, and what I mean by 9-degree, I mean if you take a straight line from the edge of this fretboard out to zero, or straight out would be zero, and then cant this down, it's actually, this particular headstock is at 9 degrees, but 9 to 10 degrees is fairly common. That, and it's also got a nice volute on it. It's a one-piece neck. It's not, doesn't have a scarf joint on it. And it also has a symmetrical taper coming from the edge of the fretboard from the nut all the way out to the edge of the blank headstock. Now, the first thing I did when getting this is I went ahead and taped a low adhesive tape just right down the middle of it, roughly, and then took an accurate measurement from the edges down to the middle and marked it accurately as possible to find the center of this board here, and then I repeated the same process here at the nut, and then took a nice straight edge and created a nice center line to follow as a guideline for my templates to sit on as we create one. Now what I need to do is start sketching for my template what is what I want. And one of the first things you want to have before even starting your design is to make sure you have the hardware that you're going to be using. And I happen to have that right now as well. And we're going to be using these bass tuner heads here. It doesn't really matter what brand you have or whatever you're going to use, but make sure that you have the ones that you are going to use so that you have the correct dimensions as far as holes that you need to drill. And it also makes it easier for when you're laying out spacing. This particular headstock is going to be a 4-inline, but could easily have been a 2x2 layout design. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take my headstock and put it on a piece of paper that I put on a board that's fairly thick. And it's about a 1/2 inch thick. It's actually going to be my template material, to be honest. But I want to be able to take my headstock and lay it flat and making it flush at the edge here so that it sits nice and flush against the nut, as well as holding it flat against the piece of paper. And what I tend to do now is I'm going to take my pencil, preferably a mechanical pencil, that way you always have a consistent end. It doesn't start getting fatter on you as you wear the lead down. And I'm going to trace out the actual size of this from the nut to the edge of the blank. Alright, so now I have the outline of the headstock blank. And I've also drawn my center line as accurately as I can down that. So now I have something that will match accurately to the actual top of the headstock. Now when I drew this, it was upside down, so technically this side would be the top, and it would go like this. You know, I actually tried drawing this earlier. But since it doesn't matter, since we have a symmetrical taper, we could just call this top. That's good enough. Now we have the outline of our headstock blank. What is also important at this point is I need to see exactly where my strings are coming out and draw a straight line coming out from them to be parallel to the center line. Now, if this were a 2x2 headstock design, thereby meaning two tuners would be on top and two on bottom, that wouldn't be so critical. The straighter you can keep your strings, the better. But a lot of times you'll see on basses that have that kind of configuration where they're split on top and bottom, you'll see them kind of reaching off the one side and the other to be able to accommodate the design of the headstock. Not so much when you see an inline style. You usually see it to where they're set in such a way that as the headstock progresses, they're placed so that they hit the strings as the string comes out and makes that, you know, intersection between the line. So now that's what I'm going to do, is I need to plot that on there. And that should be easy since I already have this laid out. And so all I got to do is match it up to where it should be sitting there and just make a little tick mark where every spot is on the nut there, the center of this nut, and then I'll be able to project that line forward. Alright, I've taken, marked where the strings will go across the nut and projected that line across the entire face of the what will be the headstock. And I've started my first line 2 inches past the face of the nut. And what I mean my first line, my first center line of where my tuning machine is going to go. Alright. And then I've decided to go 5.5 inches past that one to my last tuning machine. And when you divide that up, the spaces that will come between the rest of the tuning machines should be 1 3/8. That's about the maximum space I can get, distance I can get. They won't be straight up and down like this when you're done. They'll all be canted to follow the angle of the headstock, I think. I haven't decided yet. But that's best I can get there, so I have to design my headstock angled so that I can have 3/4 inch above the center line of where this is going to go. Now I'm going to mark my next center line 1 3/8 across from there, and then so on until I have them all marked out. And then from that center line up 3/4 inch, and then from there so on. And that will give me my angle so I can skew for how I'm going to cut this part of the board off. Okay. So what I have done, first of all, I want to explain that I made a mistake. When I was talking about dividing this, which is what I had said was 5.5, if you divide that by 4, you will come up with 1 3/8. Unfortunately, you need to only divide by 1, 2, 3, since it's only a 4-string bass. So it really comes out to just under 1 7/8, but I went ahead and just made it 1 7/8. And now my new measurement actually reaches 5 5/8. So that's normally longer than I'd want to put it, the spacing. But to accommodate the design that the client wants, I went ahead and lengthened it out because he has a fairly shallow angle going into it. So the closer you put these in, the deeper this will get if you want to keep the strings lined up. Which brings me to another point of this. Where the strings come along, well, we all know the strings aren't that thin. They actually have some thickness to it. And also, it would be incorrect to put these directly dead set on the center of the string, because the center of the string isn't coming in and then winding from the center. It's winding from the edge. These particular machines are 1/4 in diameter in the narrowest part. So I offset an additional 1/8 up plus another 1/16 to compensate for the thickness of all the strings. And I did that to every one of these. You know, so every string now has the center offset by 3/16 up. And I felt that was safe distance to get to look right when these all wrap up based on the diameter of this. Now, after I had that set, you also want to make sure that you're going, for these particular tuners anyway, you want 3/4 inch from the center here to the intersection of the top of where your headstock is going to be cut, that line that you're going to cut right there or skew across your headstock blank. So 3/4 inch measured up from here up, and 3/4 inch measured from that center up, and then it's just easy to take that and shink and go right across. Now that I have where my hardware is going to sit accurately, now I can go ahead and design what I want the bottom half of my headstock to look like as far as whatever design is going to go down here. The client has already given me what he wants as far as a general guideline, so that's now what I'm going to try and incorporate in here. And let's hopefully it comes out great. Okay, I have my headstock design drawn onto the blank now. It does look very nice and clear, but all I can really say is it's worth investing a little bit into maybe a few templates, because this is very inexpensive. It helps you make holes and circles, and it's worth it for the couple of dollars it'll cost you. Also, a protractor is really nice. It'll help you keep all your lines at a nice 90-degree angle as you're projecting all these lines. And, of course, at least a 6-inch scale with 32nd-inch markings. That being said, your best friend, while trying to sketch out your design on the freehand portion, I would say is probably just a pencil and a nice eraser. I really am not what I would call an artist, although I drafted for many years, so I do have that on my side. But just making, whatever design you're going to do, just doing quick successive lines and then coming back to try and solid that up as you work out what you want, and then, or just erasing what you don't and getting rid of the crap in between, is the best thing I could really suggest. I can't give you a class on drawing, but what you do want is, when you're finally finished with your design, to have a fairly clear outline. You don't want it to be too ambiguity. You want too much ambiguity of where you were going to go when your final line is, because you're going to be sanding and shaping right up to these lines, and maybe beyond, depending on how it feels. And sometimes some shaping goes beyond as you're working on the actual piece of template. All right. So as far as talking about the design and all that, this is finished. I've done everything as far as setting my hardware up correctly and in its correct location in relationship to how the strings are going across after they leave the nut and over the headstock. I've shaped the top of my headstock on as far as design on how I'm going to go, how much room there needs to be between the tuner machines, and I've spaced them out. Since this is a 10-degree cant headstock instead of a flat one, I don't have to worry about string trees. And that's a whole discussion on why you would even need those, but not really meant for this video. So at this point, what I need to do is get some material to match this shape and size that I could use as a template. And ba-ding, I actually cut it right off this piece right here. And this is, if you take a good look at it, it's nothing more than, it's like particle board, but it's like, I've heard it called press board, fiber board, but you can buy this at any Home Depot in 4x4 sheets and even smaller. They do sell them in 4x8 sheets. But unless you're doing this where you're constantly making templates, I doubt you would ever need anything that big. Also, thickness matters. I'd get a minimum of at least a half inch because you're going to have to do some routing. And when you're doing the routing, you're going to want the edge for your bearing to ride on. And a nice thick one is way better than having a small, narrow one. So I always prefer at least a half inch. This happened to come out the 5/8 thick. All right. Now I've already marked my center line on here, and what I intend to do is I'm going to cut out fairly close to the lines with just a pair of scissors. And but before I do that, I'm going to make a copy of this. This is my original. So actually, this is the copy. Here's my original. And I made a copy of it. Now, making a color copy was probably a bit excessive, but it helps clarify what lines are what. It just kind of helps clean it up and make it more obvious where you're trying to go. So at this point, I'm going to go ahead and do that, cut out the design, and glue it to my piece of template to start shaping. All right, I've got my template design cut out, template pattern I should say. I've got it cut out very roughly, you know, just gotta kinda get close, and now I'm ready to glue it on here. Except this isn't really necessary, but I like to do this. I wanna taper or chamfer this edge so that it matches the 9-degree angle that the headstock blank has, as opposed to the nut, which is sitting straight up in 90 degrees. And then I want an additional 10 degrees. Well, I'm going for nine actually. So I went ahead and set up my combination sander here, built this sander, and I've already set it up to, well, it was just a second ago, depending on which way the floor leans. Oh. To 9 degrees. Oh, as you can see, it's super sensitive. There we go. 9.4 is fine. I've also made sure that my miter was square to this sander as well. Now that I'm ready and set up, I can go ahead and put in that chamfer. What I've also done is I've taken my protractor and I've skewed a little line right across the top there. So I'm actually trying to get it right up to it. You can see it wasn't quite perfect cut, so there's a little leftover on that side. So I intend to try and make this not only give it the chamfer, but square it up as much as possible. Let's see here. Burn a little bit. So far, so good. Now, once again, this isn't necessary. The reason I do it is because I like the way it will sit against, more correctly against, the nut face. Now, it would have just stuck straight up like this in otherwise. And you can see a small, let's see if I can get the focus on it. Yeah, you kind of see a little bit of light there. I think it's liking something else to focus on, but so as long as the bottom edge is flush to that nut face on the bottom and is not moving back and forth, that's all that really matters. I do it because I like the it's a little more steady. It sits up against it more firmly and flushly, and just gives a better contact. All right. So now I am ready to glue. And I'm probably just going to use a spray adhesive, spray it right on there, and then set this down. Or I may use a stick, just to keep it from being so messy. Alright, I decided just to use a glue stick because it'll give, well, it's easier to use. It gives you more time to move stuff around, and if you stick it in the wrong spot, you get a chance to kind of move it. So, I always like doing it over another piece of paper, so that way you can overlap it right on the edges, and I don't mind getting it fairly thick on there. Now I can't really see what I'm doing. I'm actually doing this while looking through the camera at the same time, so I've already screwed up that by much. Obviously, the edges are the most important. I don't really care if it starts coming unglued in the middle, because all my sanding is taking place at the edges. And that's the most important part. All right. I'm probably going to lose focus a little bit while I pay attention on. Okay, so here's the deal. Let's say you did this and you didn't get it perfectly centered on your center line. Who cares? To be quite honest, your center line that really matters at this point, now this is glued on here, is the one that's drawn on here. It will affect how this is. It might not be perfectly perpendicular to the line that you have drawn on here. So if you have the ability to fix it up, just do just that. You know, just bump it up there until you can get it to sit on your fretboard, or fretboard, your headstock blank, nice and flat and perpendicular to the nut. So you got a nice straight line. At this point, I'm going to go ahead and cut a good chunk of this excess off with the old trusty bandsaw, which I think right now is set up for, it's good to go. And I would cut fairly close, even into the paper, but try and get fairly close to the lines, because you want to eliminate as much work as you have to do in sanding and shaping. That being said, try not to touch the line, but get as close as you can. And that's what I'm about to attempt. Okay, so I've cut it out pretty closely. Let's see if I can get some. There we go, kind of see how close I did get. And on the straight lines, I get pretty close, but when it comes to curves, I tend to try and leave as much... Oh, stupid camera. There we go, try and leave a little bit more room for error, you know. So how I used to do this at this point is I would clamp this in and just use hand blocks to do the final shaping. Now, if this is what you're going to be using, flat, for obviously flats, but not so obviously, the rounds. Always use a flat one for on the rounds, and then whenever you come to a round spot, I always use the obvious round. When you start getting the tighter ones, I've got, you know, I've made sanding blocks just for tight spots. The important thing is to try and keep it as flat as possible, as far as perpendicular to this edge. You want a nice flat edge for the bearing that the router is going to be riding on. I've since upgraded. I don't do that anymore. Now I come over here and I go to the spindle sander, which is great. I use the spindle sander for all my curves. I'll go in here and get most of this until I get close to this, and then I'll change out to the smaller one to fix that. But I'll get all these first. And for this flat, I'll just go over here to my belt sander and go ahead and make sure that's nice and flat there. And then I'll go ahead and just true up the round using the disc sander as I go around. Keeps everything nice and flat and perpendicular to the other surface, and is a lot faster than doing it the old hand block way. Although, if that's what you got, that's what you got. It will work. Okay, I wanted to mention that one of the reasons I hate just gluing the paper on to the template I'm trying to make is because while sanding it, the edges usually fray up and it just drives me crazy. It's not really that big of a deal, but as time has gone by, my preference is just to just cut very accurately, or as accurately as possible with scissors, the shape that you want, and stick it down and just trace the paper. It doesn't have to be perfect. But the nice thing about it is that the wood fibers will always have that line on it, and it's not going to start fraying up, or at least it shouldn't. If you had drawn it on this side, this is just a piece of paper that looks like wood grain. It would, and you can actually see a little bit. Let's see if I, it does fray up a little bit also, so it's not the, you don't want to draw on the this side either. But the, you know, this part of it, the exposed part, no problem. Anyways, it's also a good test that as you're doing this to once in a while do flip it over. Don't just look at the line that you've drawn, because the lines on here can be seething. It'll look flat just because that dark line is there, or it'll look like it's doing, you know, you've done it perfect just because you see the dark line of your pencil there. Just turn it over once in a while and actually look at the real shape of what it's coming out to be. Also, it's good to run your finger over here, and every little lump you'll feel will translate as you take the router and cut that out. That's the one thing about the spindle sander, is that those, you can get it pretty smooth and flat, but when you start getting the smaller diameter ones, they will easily start making little bump, you know, ridges. Basically, they're digging valleys out as, you know, they're sanding. So you kind of see that here even. And what I'm going to do now, I'll go ahead and put this, will do it my old school way, but it's really more or less just to dress it up now. All the hard work's over, I'm just going to try and make it feel nice and smooth and feel good. Once that's done, I'm going to translate the center line down the front of this, and I'll, I don't really need to do it on the back, but I probably will anyway, just out of habit. And then I'm going to use a scratch awl and retrace the actual taper to try and match it as closely as possible onto the template, try and make it match. And to be quite honest, if you don't plan on doing anything over here, you could just leave it flat as a stop for your router not to go any further, and it'll just, you know, which is probably what I should have done, but it's pretty easy. It just looks better to cut it out this way, and it looks cool, frankly. And it won't hurt for my router to travel over this a little bit anyways. And once I do go through all that, and I'll do it again, explain all this in the future as I get to that point, you're going to be sanding the actual headstock itself once you've routed out the shape. So, you know, things aren't too critical as far as getting it absolutely perfect right in this area. But you do want to try and keep this as close to as perfect as possible, so you're not having to do any sanding on the actual headstock. I could just leave this bumpy and then go and try and take all that out on the headstock. But it's so much easier to take it on. That's the benefit of doing it on this template, is that it's kind of a softer, easier to machine material. So anyways, time to get to it. Now I always try and hold both sides of the template, kind of cradling it between my hand to try and reference a nice flat, you know, to try and keep it as flat as possible. And I'll move it from one side to the other too, so I'm not just scraping and, you know, sanding in one spot. So I'm kind of refreshing the paper, as it were, not just loading up one spot of the paper. And I'll just continue to do this until I think it's perfect. Okay, so I've gotten my shapes as far as the front half where I like them. They feel nice and smooth. They're exactly where they should be. I went ahead and marked on my center line, and then right here at the edge, and see if I can get that to focus, and then matched it up and did the same on the back. You might notice there's a bit of a gap here between the nut and the template, and what happened was is I pushed this so that it was gonna be flush at the end here, and compensated that here. That doesn't matter because the strings are all going the straight line, so it doesn't matter if it moves forward and back some. It's just going to affect whether or not this comes back at you or forward. It's the up and down movement that really matters and keeping everything center. So now that I have it clamped down with our little block to keep things from making any compression marks on the back, I'll go ahead and score the lines as accurately as possible with a nice scratch-all. And the reason I'm choosing a scratch-all instead of just drawing it on is because there's this paper that's on there. And if I do a nice good scratch job here where I get through the paper, as I get to that line, it'll just flake right off. You'll know you've actually hit the line. This side's a little closer. Okay, and once I get this finally to the final shape, then I'm going to take it over and drill the holes for the machine head locations. Alright, so once again, I've shaped it to exactly where I like it. It feels great, everything is nice and smooth, it's the shape we want, it fits inside the headstock blank, the strings will go where the tuners are going to be set up, and now we're going to drill the holes for the tuner locations. So there's no reason to drill the full-on hole that I have marked here for the tuner since you're never going to mount them in this. This being a template, what you want to do is make it so you can easily mark where the holes are going to go on your headstock. So I'm going to drill a hole that is just big enough to allow this through, and that's why I chose this drill bit. It's the same size. Okay, so you can see that what I've done is I've cleaned up all the paper that was on here, and I just sanded it right off and had made sure that I was able to keep my original center line. I made sure I didn't sand that off. And what I had done is I basically had scored it right into the wood to make sure it didn't disappear when I got rid of the paper. I also transferred that mark all the way around so that it fit, so that I can see that center line all the way around the template, and there's a good reason for that. So as you may see that I have already put this on here on the center lines and set it up to where I liked it and went ahead and traced. I didn't try and get it perfect. I tried to make it accurate, but it's the router is not cutting on this. I'm just trying to make sure I have a guideline because I want to cut this extra wood off on the bandsaw. I can, but it's difficult when you have a cant right here. This angled headstock, because as you're trying to keep that flat, the table of the bandsaw is going to start lifting up on it, and you're going to start getting it's going to start lifting up higher and higher as you try and get it in there, and you're cutting at an angle, which you can do. That's how you do handle things like that at times. But what I'm going to do is I'm just going to basically transfer this over to the upside down so that I can put it on here and once again just estimate, because you're not going to cut right up to the line. You want to be really give it some room, but you're trying to get the excess off to keep the router from having to do so much work. And based on where this was sitting before, I know exactly pretty much where it was sitting on the back side by lining it up on the cants there. And then I'll just trace that line out. And now that I also have the trace on the other side, I can check every now and then to make sure I'm not getting too close to the final headstock shape. So I'm going to go ahead and transfer this over. There we go. Now I have the pattern on both sides. It should be fairly close to each other. They won't be exact, but like once again, I was saying, I'm not trying to get that close. I want to leave at least an eighth inch, if not more, of room before the line. Okay, as prepared to cut the excess off, there is the nut that's already on here, and even if the nut wasn't on here, the fretboard's already on here. So I can't just sit it straight flat on the table here. So what I'm using is just basically a backer, a spacer board. And it could be bigger, but I'm trying to avoid cutting into it too much. I'm trying to just basically get around that. And I'll move it as I need to. Okay, as you can see, my transfer of the pattern from the front to the back was pretty successful. You see how close I even got here, and I was like, oh crap, and turned around to check, and turns out, hey, pretty good. So I was probably a little off from, you know, it wasn't perfectly centered, because you can see it gets a little closer on some sides than others, but that's exactly why I wanted to stay away from the edges. So I successfully trimmed off the excess. Now what I want to do is now that I have all the excess, and obviously at this point there's no turning back, so I hope you like the headstock shape at this point, because you are committed. You've taken off wood, you can't put it back on. Not without it looking like crap anyway. Alright, so now I'm going to take double-sided stick tape and basically adhere that right to here as accurately as I can, and then I'll stick it in a vise, and if you don't have a vise, I'll take clamps and clamp down so you get a nice good solid mating surface. You want it to really be stuck on there, and believe me, it'll stay on there. It will have no problem hooking up. So I'm not too worried about the parts that go over. To be quite honest, that is more than enough. That's probably too much, and I'll probably have a little bit of a hard time getting it off, but it's all right. And so like areas over here where it's overlapped some, that's not really a big deal, but I don't like getting my router bits sticky with anything if I can help it. It looks like I actually missed there, way here. Just that simple. Alright. Now, getting that off is sometimes the tricky part. Here's the reel. Come on, focus. So I'm trying to do this while looking at through the camera. Of course, I'll check it before I actually do anything, but I'm going nice. I don't mind if it's back a little bit. I'd almost rather it be not quite flush, just this slightly back from this, that way the router still bites into some wood, making sure that you actually are achieving your entire shape. see anything there. Oh yeah. Now what I do to make sure I get a nice secure but you might not have one of these available. And believe me, it's on there. It's not going anywhere now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up my table router, which is under this carpet here, and just basically hold the neck upside down, which is why I'm focus here. Why I'm glad that that's another benefit to getting something this thick. I was able to cover the space of the nut. If it was, you can get away with just a quarter inch template material, but you might have a hard time getting it higher than a nut depending on what kind of nut you have on there. So I would recommend at least a minimum half inch, especially for jobs like this. Okay, I've set up my router table, and what I've done is I made sure I selected a blade that was the diameter would accommodate the design I have, and it's also large enough I can do it in a single pass without having to raise or lower the blade. In other words, the bearing will sit nicely on the template material while the blade will cut against all of the wood and even overlap it some. So now I'm ready. Of course, you want to work slowly. You don't want to just dive it in there. Take up a little bit of time. Okay, as you can see, I have finished routing out my headstock design. The template's still attached to it. I got a couple of little bit of burning in some of the edges. I don't care. I'll be able to sand that out just fine. A little bit more work, but that's how it goes. Now, before I detach the template, the last thing I got to make sure I do is mark my holes. So now that I have that there, it's going to hold it. All I got to do is stick it right in there and it'll mark up every one accurately. Alright, now it's a matter of moving this, and twisting action is usually better. I don't know if you'll be able to see them. Yeah, kind of. There you go. One there, you can see it working its way down. So now I'm going to drill the tuner holes for the headstock. I wanted to explain something about what's going on here. You can see on my headstock here the dots right next to here. Here's I pulled this one 1/8, and this is a quarter, and now from the original dot 3/8 in. After observing and looking at the headstock design I cut out from the template that I made here, the more I saw the tuner on it, the more it just didn't look right, and I wanted to pull it in. Of course, as soon as I pull that in, that changes the angle that I have here, because I want to keep the same straight line that I've already set up for where this is supposed to go as far as the intersection here and here, my X and Y. So as I pull this in, my angle of this drops in order to keep the same amount of space above the tuner. and you can see that observed. What I did is I basically just calculated it out right on top of the headstock, and after finding out exactly where I wanted to move them to, they're now, instead of 1 7/8, they're now 1 3/4. So I pulled everything in, basically a full eighth. And it looks much better, but you can see the difference, which isn't much, but how much I had to take off the top of there to make it so that the angle will still be correct to, in relationship to where my tuners are gonna sit. So I just wanted you to be aware of that, that you can make some design changes on the fly, but you have to make sure you're careful as to what you move, especially after you've already placed your hardware in a 4-in line. If you're doing a 2x2 style, you probably wouldn't be changing much, to be honest. They're fairly simple designs. So anyways, like I said before, I'm going to go ahead and drill through for the holes. Well, I'm going to go ahead and drill pilot holes, guide holes basically, all the way through the front side, since I have them marked on the front side and not the back. Then once I have my holes penetrating all the way through, I'll see where they're supposed to be, and on the back side, with the aid of a backer board on the top, I will drill all the way through the correct size hole that I need for the tuners. Alright, so same issue, because there's an angle between the headstock and the fretboard, and because of the location of where the drill bit is on the table, I won't be able to get this in flat on the table. So basically I've made a little elevation table that to help keep me to help the neck miss, basically, is what I'm trying to get it to do while I go ahead and drill my holes. I'm going to start with the farthest one first. I'm going to have to look away as I line this up. Here we go. Oops, sorry about that. So now that I have it lined up, I often line it, put it right on there before I even start the drill, just to keep the end play from messing with it. And then while holding it, using my calipers, I measured out this to be at, let's see if I can get it to focus, at 5.48 really, but just for our purposes, 0.55, which is just a little over 1/2 inch, of course, and but that's off by a good 5 thousandths there, and that's a quite a bit, actually, of wood to try and hog out. I can get a, without my finger being in the way, you know, indifference. But this is the biggest drill bit I have. I probably could run down to Home Depot and find one just slightly over, but I'm just going to use one of these, and it's basically a reamer, and I'll hog out the excess wood as needed to get a nice tight fit, and that's how I plan to do it. So this is the bit I'm going to go ahead and use, even though it's a slightly undersized of the size I need for the tuning machines. All right, I have my drill set up, and as I said, I have a backer board, and this will do two things. It'll help prevent tear out, and of course, it's keeping the fact that I have a bump here. I can't lay the headstock flat on this table, so this is like when I was doing the bandsaw. Helping me with that. So now I'm ready to go. Nice and clean on the other side. I just have to do it 3 more times. Alright, I have my holes drilled through. And one thing I should have done before when it was the little 16th inch, the small holes that I drilled through for guides, is I should have taken a straight edge and made a nice line skewing through that to show the centers of where all these are going to go. That way it would have made it easier for when I put these down to see exactly where the hole for the mounting screw to keep this thing from turning one way or the other as you tighten the strings. Yeah, get that in the focus a little better. You kind of see the line going through. I had to kind of eyeball it. Luckily I have, a pretty good amount of experience. But it would have been much easier with just the little small holes to do that. Alright, another thing I want to point out is that you may have noticed that this fits right in there without a problem. It's not this side or this part of the tuner that's not fitting in, it's the sleeve that's going to go over it. So when I'm reaming out these holes to make them bigger, I'm going to only do it from the front side. I might do a little from the back side just to get it, to make sure that I can get this to fit, because these are pretty much going to go all the way through. You can see right there the thickness of this. So I'll need to get them at least that thick at the bottom, and then I'll start from the top and ream through until it goes through, and then I'll do that for each one. So it's hard to see very good depth perception with, because I'm literally watching, as I've said several times already, through the camera that I have mounted on my headset, believe it or not. So my depth perception is not very good. Back up. Oh yeah, see, it's just barely wanting to fit in. So I got that pretty good. I might give it a little more turns. Just a little bit more from this side. Oh yeah, no problem. Now the rest of the way is from this side. See, this thing is working its way deeper down in there. Probably gonna have to be almost to the top of the threads by the time it actually fits. Tight fit. I actually like that. The fact that it does fit and it's tight. So that's what I'm going to go for on every one of these. And you can see, it only took me a few minutes to do, but it's kind of a pain in the butt. I'm sure it would be easier if I just went out and finally bought the drill bit size that I really need. It would save me some time. Okay, once you've completed making sure that all your type of hardware fits, once it all fits, most tuning machines are going to have that final little screw head you have to align. So now would be a good idea is to go ahead and put in all your tuning machines, and then we'll turn it over and mark that final screw head location. Now that I have my tuners on there and lined up and looking pretty good, the last thing I want to do is go ahead and mark the location of my little screw holes here. And I used a little scratch awl and marked the locations. Alright, and then I've set up a 1/16 inch drill bit to match the screws that are going in there. They're actually black, I just happen to have this chrome one here. And I set it up with a little depth gauge so that I don't go any farther than that, that it matches the screw. You can see that. Actually, I'll probably stop just a little short of it, which is fine. Now I'll go ahead and remove these and drill those holes that I've marked. Alright, that is it. You've finished shaping and drilling it to, so that you can mount all your hardware. In the next video, I'm going to start talking about finishing, because this neck is completely unfinished and obviously it's dirty. I've been gripping all over it. You can see all the dirt on it that's happened as the work has progressed on it, not to mention just the marks I've made all over it as I've gone. So now it's time to sand it smooth, make it look really good, fix all these little burn marks, and get it down to a 220 grit to prepare it for paint. And that'll be the start of the next video.